morning. I can't hear you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Okay. See, it's a sunny day. We have to be happy, okay? Hear me out. Just saying. Anyways, good morning, guys. If you would stand and join me in this song, but first, let me say one thing. So today is Palm Sunday, and so if you notice, you get a palm when you come in. And there are a few people in this church that know how to make a cross out of the palm, and I am one of them. before I was a part of this, a lot of times I would sit in the pews and I would just be doing it while Pastor Joe was reading his stuff. So, and people would just come up to me and be like, hey, can you do this for me? And I'm like, yeah, sure. So, yeah, if you need it, just find me and I'm here somewhere. I usually am. So, yeah. All right. Please join us in singing this song this morning.
And as we sing, the kids should be joining us on the parade of their palms.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the blood that makes me white as snow. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. One thing can for sin atone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not for good that I have done. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that nothing but the blood of Jesus. But the blood of Jesus is enough for me. Yes, the blood of Jesus is enough. Oh, this is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus is enough for me. Yes, the blood of Jesus is enough. Yes, the blood of Jesus is enough for me. Yes, the blood of Jesus is enough.
Seated. And thank you to our children and to Abby, our children's ministries director, for bringing our children in. They'll be in Sunday school this morning, but for sharing in our start to Palm Sunday, a Sunday wherein we remember Jesus' triumphant entry as a king into the city of Jerusalem. My name is Jeremy Africa, and as the pastor here at Otsego United Methodist Church, along with one of our praise teams and Karen Andrews, who is our liturgist this morning, we welcome you and hope that you experience our time together as a place where Jesus' love is lived. here on this Palm Sunday, on this last Sunday of Lent, 40 days leading up to Easter. We finish up a Lenten sermon series on the Lord's Prayer, as well as celebrate again the time when Jesus triumphantly entered Jerusalem to the waving of branches, the laying down of cloaks, and indeed those who cheered him on, saying, "Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord." And indeed, all this is in preparation of the Holy Week to come. And so we come together to worship on this day. If you're here in our sanctuary, hopefully on your way in, you've picked up a worship folder, a bulletin, contains all that is going on in the life of the church. And also with that bulletin, hopefully you picked up a communication card. This is our way of connecting and staying connected as a church. I invite you to drop those communication cards in our offering plates this morning. If you're worshiping with us online, we are glad that you are also with us. Invite you to wave hello to one another and to us in the comment section of whatever platform that you are on. We're glad to stay connected with you as well. Your worship bulletins you will find in your email. If you aren't yet receiving those, invite you to contact the church office, and we'd be happy to add you to that mailing list. Speaking of our bulletin today and announcements we have to highlight, do want to lift up the announcement that provides an update regarding the ongoing conversation and discernment that we are having within our church relative to the General Conference. Our leadership team met this past Tuesday, and at this meeting I presented our church leaders a possible path of discernment and decisions. This plan contains tangible steps that we might take as a congregation to resolve all the matters before us, most of all, which path best supports us continuing to be a vital church here in our community. And so there are the paths of perhaps joining the Global Methodist Church, perhaps staying a United Methodist Church, or even considering becoming a non-denominational or community church. And so we are doing our best to discern what path sets our church on the most solid footing for the future. And the path that we are laying out, or the plan that we are laying out, provides, as I mentioned, tangible steps we might take. This includes providing our congregation with a easy-to-understand guide as to the differences between the Global Methodist Church and the United Methodist Church. Indeed, it is a complex conversation that we're trying to hold, and so we hope to provide you with a guide to understand the differences that we are considering. This path towards resolving this might also include conducting a congregation-wide survey. So providing an opportunity for you as our congregation to express your voice as to what might happen depending on what path we might go down. And likely will also, this path before us will include likely voting on whether to leave the United Methodist Church. All of this, again, is an effort to resolve what is before us. They are important matters, but in resolving those matters, equips our church to continue the work that we are truly all sharing in, and that is being a place here in our community where people can come and where we go out as a place that lives Jesus' love. And so all of that is in your bulletin this morning. Not in your bulletin is an announcement regarding a leadership and design team meeting after church today, and this is again related to our work preparing for the General Conference. This meeting will be 30 minutes after the conclusion of our worship today, And the sole matter at this meeting is to share with our church's leaders new information that we've received from Reverend Bagley this week regarding United Methodist churches wishing to leave the denomination at this time. And so that leadership team and design team combined meeting will take place after worship today. As a reminder, our meetings of our leadership team are open to the congregation, so everyone is invited to attend this meeting and all other leadership team meetings. But please note that this is not a town hall meeting to discuss all that is before us. Instead, it's simply to convey information to our church's leaders, and that will be the purpose of our meeting today. So an awful lot before you. If you have any questions, I certainly encourage you to approach perhaps one of our chairs of our leadership team, which include Craig Sisson and Larry Hill, or the chairperson of our staff parish relations committee, who is Jim Miller, or myself. We certainly also want to take a deep breath and to be reminded of the important week before us. Indeed, it is Holy Week. And so I want to share with you our schedule for this coming week. We have our Women's Lenten Breakfast hosted by our United Women in Faith, and that will take place this coming Wednesday at 9:30, and will feature the testimony of Jeannie Van Eerden. More information on this breakfast and all the services I'll be lifting to you are in your bulletin. Also want to invite you to our Maundy-Thursday service, which is a quiet service intended to remind us of Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples and his commandment to love one another. This will feature a service written by the Reverend Dan Miner and sharing in Holy Communion, and this will be at Thursday at 6:30. This service will be live streamed if you're unable to join us, so I invite you to join us for worship online as well if you're unable to attend in person. And then also Good Friday this week, we have our interactive prayer stations meant to create space in your day, whether it's with yourself or with family or with friends or neighbors, to reflect on Jesus' love shown to us through Jesus' suffering on the way to the cross and indeed on the cross itself. And this year we will have crafts as part of that day, so if you have younger children who need to move about as you go through these stations of the cross, we'll have crafts downstairs for our younger children. Indeed, if you have children who might be elementary age or older, they too might appreciate going through the interactive station. So we do have all of that on Good Friday. Much thanks to Deb Agnew and the team around her to make this possible. This will be this coming Friday from noon to 2 and then 4 to 6. And then highlight our Easter Sunday service, which is this coming Sunday, of course. We will celebrate together here in our sanctuary, celebrating the good news of God raising Jesus from the dead and the hope that that brings us today. We won't have children's or youth Sunday school that Sunday, so we'll all worship together. As part of the service, our classic choir, an ensemble from our bell choir, will be leading us in worship. Certainly encourage us to invite friends and family members, neighbors, to share in Easter's good news. All this information and all the details, even further details, are in your bulletin, so I encourage you to be mindful of that. Encourage you to set aside that time to know the depth of God's love for us and the hope that it provides. So certainly want us to be mindful of that as we step into Holy Week. With all this, Karen, I'm going to invite you to come forward to share our opening prayer.
Heavenly Father, what amazing grace that you should send your only begotten Son to come to earth as the heavenly Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, and also as the human son of King David, who will set up a kingdom of peace and prosperity on earth. Thank you that you love the world so much that you chose to send your son to die on the cross so that we might live. Thank you that your plan of redemption does not exclude anyone, Gentile or Jew, and all who call on the name of the Lord in faith will be saved. Help us to live our lives in a way that honors your name, and thank you that all your plans and purposes for the salvation of mankind and the restoration of the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. At this time, I want to invite forward our ushers for the giving of this morning's tithes and offerings. If you're a guest of our church, or if this is one of your first few times worshiping with us this morning, simply invite you to sit back and to share in this time, remembering the abundance of God's love and God's blessings in our lives. If you're a member of our congregation, indeed, this is a time for us to share in the giving of tithes and offerings to financially support the vision and the work of our church. And so let us pray.
Will you bow your heads with me? Almighty and everlasting God, as we bring our gifts and lay them at your altar, we remember the crowds in Jerusalem who laid their cloaks on the road, shouting Hosanna as Jesus passed. We know they were looking for a Messiah who was different from whom you sent Jesus to be, not one of political power and military might, but one who came in compassion and mercy to heal, love, and save. Search our hearts that we might be confident that the Messiah for whom we long is the one you know we need. Jesus Christ, your anointed one, in whose name we pray. Amen.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. It's man's empty praise, treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place in your mercy and grace won't find me again. Will you sing? Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You turn beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. Lord, the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can.
Let's sing that more time.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Oh, there's
nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn seas into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
This morning's scripture comes to us from the book of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. If you'd like to follow along with me, please turn to page 792 in your pew Bible. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches as they had cut in the field. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David! Hosanna in the highest!' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Would you stand with us and would you sing?
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing. Son of heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roared for Christ as the King.
Let's sing out.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, our God. He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Praise his name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
Sing out.
Oh, praise the name. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, our God. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, our God. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, our God.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations and thoughts of our hearts be pleasing to you. For you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Here on Palm Sunday, we finish our church's Lenten series, sermon series on the Lord's Prayer. Throughout Lent, we've turned to the Reverend Adam Hamilton and his study, The Lord's Prayer. the meaning and power of the prayer Jesus taught. And so if you joined us throughout the last 5 weeks, you might recall we've been considering the meaning of this prayer that Jesus prayed when teaching his disciples how to pray, as well as how understanding this prayer and praying it often can tune our hearts to God's heart. And so going line by line through this familiar and beloved prayer, we've considered what it looks like to hallow God's name, or what it means to glorify God's name with our lives. We've considered what it looks like to share in God's pursuit of bringing God's kingdom here on earth. We've looked at the significance of praying for our daily bread, not just your daily bread or not just my daily bread, but our daily bread, and the true nature of forgiving those who sin against us. And indeed, we've even begun a 40-day prayer vigil ahead of the General Conference, wherein we are praying together as a church. Yes, God, lead us. Today we turn our attention to the closing line, to the doxology of the Lord's Prayer. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. It turns out these closing words in praise of God are not found in either of the gospel accounts of the Lord's Prayer. Adam Hamilton points out they don't appear in the earliest or most authoritative manuscripts of Matthew's gospel, and therefore they're left out in many translations of the Bible today, and they are altogether left out in Luke's gospel, or Luke's telling of this prayer. But Hamilton points out that this doxology, this closing line in the prayer, is not without basis. Not only does this doxology appear in some of the ancient manuscripts of Matthew's gospel, Hamilton brings up the fact that this doxology also has a basis in a prayer of King David found in 1 Chronicles, wherein David prays, "Yours, O Lord, are the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom." And Hamilton also points out that a writing of the early church dating back to the first or second century called the Didache, which was used to instruct believers in the faith, included this line in this Lord's Prayer. It's from this document that we get the encouragement to pray this prayer 3 times a day. And instructing believers to pray this prayer, it includes this closing line, this closing doxology, this blessing to God. And so there's a good reason why we conclude the Lord's Prayer by praying, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." At its core, in its essence, the closing of the Lord's Prayer has to do with the disposition of our hearts. It has to do with what we set as our heart's desire. As Adam Hamilton puts it in the 2nd chapter of his book, we're choosing here at the end of the prayer between praying me and mine or thy and thine. Indeed, here at the close of the Lord's Prayer, and really throughout it, more than trying to incline or turn God's heart towards us when we pray, instead of trying to convince God towards our desires, what we are doing here with the Lord's Prayer, we are praying for God to turn our hearts towards Him, towards our Heavenly Father, to shape our hearts and to shape our desires for what God wants for us. It's not about my kingdom or my power or my glory. Instead, in praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, we are submitting ourselves to God. We are surrendering ourselves to God. For thine, for yours, God, is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Thinking of this part of the Lord's Prayer, I think about those times when I've had the privilege to be with families as they're gathered around their loved ones. In particular, when one is nearing the end of life. While indeed there is room to pray at those times for what we want, what often happens? We certainly express our desire that God might bring healing, that God might bring perhaps one more day, perhaps even one more hour. But so often, what happens at the end of those prayers? Well, we surrender ourselves. And we surrender those we love the most over to God. Sometimes finding the courage to pray, not my will, but thy will. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. So each time we sincerely pray this prayer that Jesus has taught us, we surrender ourselves and we surrender our ways to God. With our prayers and our lives, we are directing our being and we are directing our hearts to the ways of God. We are praying, God, help me in the work of making my life all about you and not me. End quote. Now, if that sounds intense, to surrender our lives, to surrender our ways, to surrender our beings over to God, well, that's because it is. In praying for God's kingdom, we submit to God as the ultimate authority over us and over everything and over all of creation. In praying for God's power, we turn all power, including our own, over to God. And in praying for God's glory, we place everyone else's glory, including ours, secondary to God's. Is it intense to truly do that with our lives? And with our loved ones, and with our influence, in our community, to turn those things over to God. I do believe it is intense. And yet this is what we pray. We only need to turn to Jesus on this Palm Sunday to see how intense or how radical life gets when we surrender our lives over to God, over to the building of God's kingdom, over to God's power and glory. Here on Palm Sunday, we embrace the celebratory image of Jesus' victorious and somewhat royal entry into Jerusalem. We did it with our children. We did it ourselves with the waving of palm branches. To some degree, we even relive it with our own branches here in the sanctuary. We relive this entry into Jerusalem that Jesus had. And why not? After all, who doesn't like an underdog story? It's why we root for grizzly bears from Oakland, right? And Bulldogs from Yale. I know I'm losing some of you, but that's all right. We root for Bulldogs from Yale and antelopes from the Grand Canyon, right? And all this madness that March brings. I'm going to refrain from the Spartans because my Wolverines didn't even make the party. They didn't even make the JV party. So, But here, going back to Jesus, Jesus is turning everything on its head. Jesus is turning the religious establishment and the Roman Empire on its head by riding into Jerusalem like a king and yet on a donkey, with people waving palm branches and laying their cloaks on the road as they would have done for royalty, shouting blessing on the one who comes in the name of the Lord, blessings on the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. And so that scene is familiar, and we relive it, and we almost, I imagine that we embrace that joy and that celebration, and knowing that Jesus is King. But then again, we only need to stick around a bit longer to hear the exulting crowds fade into the background. All the palms and cloaks used to line the streets, which would have been reserved for a conquering hero, are all but a distant memory as this crowd grows silent. With contrasting silence, Jesus offers his disciples broken pieces of bread as a reminder of his body, which is given for you. And the cup of wine, a symbol of God's covenant with God's people, one confirmed by Jesus' own blood. Of course, all of this gives way to Jesus' prayer with his disciples. No, not this time teaching them how to pray, but this time in the garden. And it gives way to Judas' betrayal, and the mockery of a trial, and the cowardly ways, perhaps, of Pilate. And indeed, Jesus' crucifixion between two criminals and his final words on the cross, "It is finished." For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Ultimately, this is what surrendering to God and surrendering to God's will, ultimately, this is what it looks like in Jesus' life as the Son of Man and as the Son of God. What might it look like to submit our lives in the same way over to God, to God's hearts, to God's ways, to God's kingdom, power, and glory? And so as we wrap up our Lenten series on our Lord's Prayer, is there someone or something that you need to surrender over to God? Someone or something that you need to be praying, or that we need to be praying, not me and mine, but thy and thine. In the quiet of this sanctuary, or in the quiet of your homes, is there a situation in your life that needs to be surrendered over to God? Is there a relationship with a loved one, perhaps even someone you need to forgive, that needs turning over to God. Are you holding on to a preconceived notion of what is or what ought to be that needs to be surrendered over to God and over to God's will and over to God's way? We're doing a 40-day prayer vigil, 40 days of praying purposefully ahead of General Conference for our church. And so being a bit of a numbers geek, I'm trying to work on being more intuitive, but God's still working on me. So I had to do the numbers. How many stones were picked up last Sunday? 118. And so if each of us pray a prayer for our church, if each of us pray a prayer for our congregation, if each of us pray a prayer for our community, saying, not my will, but thy will, that's 4,720 prayers. I did this on my calculator, so I know the math is good. It's 4,720 prayers. But as I see it, it's 4,720 times for us to turn all of this over to God. And so what is it in our church? What is it in our lives? What is it in our community that we need to surrender? For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Surely one of the ways that we surrender ourselves to God, and one of the reminders we have on a weekly basis of living in surrender to God, is our time in prayer together. So I'm going to direct our attention to our prayer list on the front of our bulletin. We'll find the names of those we are praying for. And new to our list this week, we've added Mary's brother, David. So let us pray for David at this time. And as you might know, as a practice of our congregation in Lent, we also provide the opportunity to dedicate a cross that will be hung in our fellowship hall in memory or honor of loved ones. And so today we have several crosses to dedicate here in our worship time together. Josie Pape is giving this cross to be hung in our fellowship hall in memory of her late husband, Philip. And Philip was a skilled tradesman, and so this cross made of wrenches reminds Josie of her late husband, Philip, and so we lift Philip up in our prayers in remembering him alongside Josie. And Carrie Pullen and Kyler Wallace, who is Josie's daughter and granddaughter, give us this cross to be hung in our fellowship hall. This cross is in memory of Dale Wallace, who was Carrie's late husband and Kyler's late father. Dale loved the outdoors, and so they wished to celebrate his memory with hanging of this cross of deer antlers and silhouette of a deer in our fellowship hall. And then Myrna Jacobson. Myrna, hopefully you're with us online today. Myrna gives us this cross to be hung in our fellowship hall in memory of her late husband, Marv. This cross is meaningful to her as it was made by Bob Hoover, who was a lifelong friend of Marv, whose friendship Marv and Bob, they struck up beginning in the 1950s. So a longtime friend has made this cross in memory of Marv, and so we hang it in our fellowship hall in memory of him. Also want to share a joy with our congregation. I'm hoping I can remember all the details right. But Ashley Goodrich completed a run with fellow students from the University of Michigan, Michigan Run Club. Is that right, David? They began a run across our state from underneath the Ambassador Bridge to South Haven, straight. Like, I don't even know I can make that drive without getting sleepy. But Ashley Goodrich and the Michigan Run Club completed this run just early this morning. They do this as a way to raise awareness and funds. They've raised funds now. These are for the Special Olympics. And so just lift that up as a joy. I know that David and Anne Marie have done a faithful job, as so many parents of this congregation have, of planting seeds of Jesus' love in Ashley and all of her siblings. But I also believe that this church's place in Ashley's life has also done that job of planting seeds of Jesus' love and helping her see the world through Jesus' eyes. And so we celebrate that as a joy. And just want to continue to encourage us to pray daily for our church, to pray daily for the work that will take place at General Conference, to pray daily for the decisions that our delegation will make from Michigan representing our church and representing us, and most of all, praying for our congregation's discernment of the path ahead. So invite us to those prayers. Also want to invite you one last time, if you're wishing to come forward during prayer time to tie a knot on the Lenten cross up front here, invite you to do so. It's just a simple way of doing a purposeful act in lifting to God our prayers, whether they're of thanksgiving or of concern or of joy. And so invite you to that time as we pray together this morning. I will lead us in a time of prayer and then leave room for silent prayers and meditations, and then we will share together in praying the prayer that indeed Jesus has taught us. So let us pray. Lord, in this time together, we seek to walk alongside you. And in walking alongside you, we once again remember when your path was filled with the joy of palm branches and the honor of those branches and cloaks being laid before you as king. And indeed, O Lord, we want to live lives. We want to make decisions. We want to to embody the very spirit that cries out to you as the King of Kings. But if, Lord, if we follow you this week, we indeed know that the waving of branches and those cheers that cry out to you as King, we know that those cheers grow quiet. And we're reminded that there are times too when our own voices and our own lives and our own hearts grow quiet. When we stray from living lives that honor you as King. When we find ourselves on a path that hardly reflects that you are Lord. But even in those seasons, Lord, even in those times, when we wrestle to pray thy will, we pray and we hope and we know that your love and your grace is sufficient for us. Lord, help us to see the depth of your mercy, the depth of your forgiveness, the power of your redeeming hands as we walk alongside Jesus in the week to come. Help us to hear anew again his commandment to love one another. Help us to have the courage to face the cross unafraid. And indeed, O Lord, even now, begin that work that will allow us to celebrate the hope of Jesus being raised from the dead by you and you alone. Lord, we know of this goodness and we know of this grace that we speak about because we have seen it in the lives of those we love and those who have gone before us. So we dedicate these crosses in memory of loved ones, in memory of Philip, in memory of Dale, in memory of Marv. And Lord, as we seek to continue to do the work of being your church, continue to hear each one of our prayers. Continue to remind us to pray, thy will be done. Here in the Otsego Church, here in our community of Otsego, in Plainwell, and beyond. Hear each one of our prayers and help us to see already how your Holy Spirit is guiding us. And even as we pray for our church and as we pray for one another, we rightfully pray for ourselves. And Lord, for those situations that you have brought to mind here in our sanctuary, here in our homes, here in our lives, that need surrendering to you. Help us to find such courage to pray for your kingdom and your power and your glory. Indeed, O Lord, in these next few moments of quiet, hear the prayers we are lifting to you now. In your very name, as you have taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
You stand and sing with us. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arms, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever. From the rising sun to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. He's forever, God is faithful. Forever, God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever, forever.
forever, forever. His love endures 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 forever.
It's tempting to go from the joy and the exaltation of Palm Sunday and skip ahead to the empty grave. Because when life is good, it is easy to surrender to God. To turn over ourselves and the people we love and the situations we face to God when things are good. But in the nailing of the cross, we're reminded that Jesus' path, yes, took him to the upper room, but it also took him to the garden and to the cross and to the darkness of death in the grave. But even in those times, we remember that God is good and that his love endures forever. So let us continue to walk with Jesus and let us continue to pray, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Was blind, but now I see.
Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. 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 His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever.